Testing, 1, 2, testing. Just a few last minute notes. What's up guys, welcome back to the channel. Hope you're having a fantastic day. Today I am bringing you my album review of Jethro Tull's Aqualung, released in 1971. It is their fourth album and their best selling and possibly most well known album. Of course, like with many of the other reviews, you can go back and listen to my first reactions of each of the songs on this album as well. I'll leave them in a playlist for you down in the description below, possibly even in a comment in the comments down below. So what can we say about Jethro Tull's most well-known album? Well, I think that initially there's something here to satisfy all listeners. There's something for everyone on this album. No matter what genres you like or what kind of sounds you like, if you want something hard, heavy-hitting, nice big hard rock riffs, you're going to be happy with Aqualung, Cross-Eyed Mary, songs like that. If you're into the more folky and fanciful, try Mother Goose, Wondering Out Loud, sweet sentimental songs that are just there to draw you in, have fun with. If you want progressive epics, why not try My God? Now that's a song. And you know, for an album that has such diversity, I think one of the things that makes this album so good is the flow between all of the songs. It's extremely well-paced, it maintains a really nice and even flow as it continues on, and not a moment feels lost, not a song feels like filler, nothing feels unnecessary. One of the main reasons why the album flows and moves so nicely is because of some of the more transitional songs. Songs that are there to more act as a bridge between the more regularly timed and longer songs in the album. And it's these shorter transition songs that really carry a really nice rhythm throughout the album, almost acting as little respites, little musical vignettes to kind of carry the story forward, to kind of carry the album forward. And it's funny because I had read some other comments and reading some other thoughts from people and what they thought of the album, and I saw a few comments that said that the album didn't flow well. And I thought for an album with this many songs, I think it flows extremely well. I actually think that that's one of the best things about the album is just the way that it moves. And while not every song on the album feels like the greatest thing ever since sliced bread, I mean, I think that as a whole, you can definitely feel why it earns its place in one of the most acclaimed albums in progressive rock. Aqualung, the title track, opens the album probably with one of the most iconic riffs in Jethro Tull's discography, but I would even say in rock music. I mean, even before I've heard the song Aqualung, I knew that riff, you know? And it's a great opener, not just in the way that the song sounds, but in the way that it showcases every single member of the band. From bars, fantastic, fiery guitar, especially with that riff, to John Evans on the piano, to, of course, the showman and the leading man himself, Annie Anderson. The whole song has a dirty and grimy feel to it, and not just because of the titular character, but just the way that the monstrous guitar and the bass sound, that riff is so dirty, I keep on coming back to it. But really, the song is much more than just the riff. And then Cross-Eyed Mary really continues that same theme with some more hard-hitting guitar, some really fantastic vocals as well. And while it continues that rock and roll trend, it approaches it with a little bit more of a groove in it. And I would say that especially it's Hammond's bass guitar that is carrying a lot of the weight in this one. Now, even though these first two songs are really good in their own right, I gotta admit, they're actually two of my least favorite on the album. And when I say least favorite, I mean like they're really good songs. But this album is one of those few albums that actually gets a lot better the further in you get. And to me, the first hints of this greatness, besides the opening tracks, because I mean, they're hints of greatness. There's huge, huge hints of greatness. But the first really hints to me that we're going to be getting into some deeper territory is the next song, Cheap Day Return. It's this first transitional song, this first acoustic bridge that we come to that really slows everything down, allows us to kind of breathe a little bit and take on some of the more emotional tones that Jethro Tull is inviting us to listen to. It's a strangely relatable track as Ian stands at the train station wondering how his father is. His father being left in a nursing home or a hospital of some sort and just wondering, are the nurses taking care of him? It's just short song, incredibly sweet, very sentimental, and incredibly thoughtful. And I think that that thought-provoking question and theme really carries through into the other songs as well, as I would say they really do provoke our thoughts. Mother Goose is one of my favorite songs on the album, and I would say that specifically the bridge between Cheap Day Return and Mother Goose is so fantastic. It really makes me feel good. I love the way that the music comes in on Mother Goose. I love the delivery of it. It's incredibly playful. It makes me feel like I'm in a medieval town square with its whimsical flute and guitar stylings, relaxed percussion, which I really enjoy. It has a very adventurous feel to it, and it has an incredibly playful spirit as well. Wondering Aloud is another one of those songs that finds Ian and the band in a more intimate setting. Its soft-spoken vocals and its joyful delivery really bring about and carry that joyful spirit into the song. The silver-lined piano leads by Evans is just sparkling and icing on the cake. I guess you wouldn't really add sparkling on cake, but they do have glitter sprinkles, which is kind of the same thing. And then the beautiful, rich, and orchestral arrangements that sweep in and really just carry away by Dee Palmer. Magical. And even though this is another one of those transition songs in the album, once again, it doesn't feel like a filler transition song. It feels like it belongs, and it's the connecting threads between the songs and in the album. Feeling more like veins which connect the lifeblood of the album rather than just tendons. Up to Me is a perfect mix between rock and roll and sharp acoustics. I love the flute in this. I really love Ian singing in here as well. Really dabbling between, like I said, the more hard rock edge, and then even softening up his voice, becoming more full-fledged in his vocal stylings as it moves into the softer sections and the spaces open up. We have a monstrous riff by Martin, which I don't know if you guys know, but Martin comes up with some pretty tasty riffs pretty much in every single song. But between the guitar, between the flute, I mean, this song just brings it. But then we get into the main chorus. Then we get to what I would call the hump day of the album. We get to My God. To me, possibly the best song that I've heard from Jethro Tull. This to me is like the epic that I come for. This is the show. You know, this is not the opening acts. Even though they were great. But this is like the show, with its darkly mysterious opening guitar, which as soon as you hear the first few notes of, you know that you're in for something. You don't know what it is, but you know that you're in for something. And what that something is that monster of a guitar riff that comes in surprisingly like a jump scare halfway through one of the acoustic riffs. I mean, that thing is huge. Sounds like the bells are just tolling for someone. It's an incredibly huge drop in the guitar. Ian sounds just as angry as ever, but it's an anger with intelligence. It's not just pure emotion. It's actually intelligent anger. Spitting out his words with thematic disgust. And then it moves into one of the coolest sections that I've heard from Jethro Tull so far. But the mix between the chanting and the flute playing, which reminds me of the Pied-Eyed Piper, which I mentioned in the original video as well. But the way that the chanting tries to follow the flute playing is so interesting and so well conceived. I mean, this song just has it all, and I think that this is probably the best song and my favorite song on the album. Hymn 43, following up, like perfectly following up, by the way, to me showcases Ian's best vocal performance on the album. He really lets his voice soar and rip throughout this song. It's an incredible mix of blues and hard rock, and I mean, the blues, he really like shows it. You know, this is Azul. Martin's guitar work, once again, fantastic. Drumming from Clive, wouldn't change it. I mean, musically, this is just like an eruption after we've already traveled to the top of the volcano.
But then, once again,
we need to quiet things down a little bit, just a tad, come back to another bridge, another transitional song, this time with Slipstream, kind of carrying the same weight and the same purpose as the other ones that we've heard already. Just another bridge between the epics. I don't feel like this one stands out as much, but it is a piece that doesn't necessarily need to stand out as much as it leads into the next track, Locomotive Breath. You guys ready to get on the hype train?
Choo-choo!
This song picks up steam as we near the ending of the album. Once again, absolutely fantastic instrumental work, beautiful and crazy singing. Evans and Barr really conduct this train with some fantastic rock and roll, hard rock and blues riffs, setting up this song, putting us on another adventure that we're about to take. One of the coolest things about this track is the rhythm section, because the song actually does have a very locomotive and train-like feel to it as it picks up steam, as it gathers speed, and as it just blows through station to station. Ian's emphatic delivery in between the riffs, which leave a lot of space for him before, you know, you could feel the wheels chuck, chuck, chuck. This is them, to me, taking blues to a completely different level. To me, so far in this album, it actually feels so unique to them. I haven't heard another band that's quite doing the same style that they're doing. Yes, there's been a lot of blues rock and that kind of thing, you know, blues and folk, but Jethro Tull really does have their own style. And then we move into Wind Up, which is the perfect closer to the album, I would say. It's very sentimental. Ian's singing is extremely earnest. It's as soft and melodic as it is a nice and rocking ending. And it's a fantastic send-off for this historical album. This feels like true rock and roll closure. This feels like Ian really feeling celebratory in not just the albums that they've all put together, but the band is really taking it all in stride. The band is really putting their best foot forward in this album, in the closing song. It's a grand celebration. The music sounds celebratory. I mean, what more could you ask out of a performance like this? So that was just a little bit of my thoughts and feelings on the songs individually thus far on the album. But now let's get into my favorite moment on the album, my favorite lyrics, and my song rankings for Jethro Tull's Aqualung. My favorite moments on the album is From My God, and it is that riff. Do I even need to specify which riff it is? It's that riff, you know? Bum, ba da bum, bum, bum. I mean, the way that it comes in, like I said, it's like a jump scare, especially the first time I heard it. I like how it really comes in near the ending of one of the bars. That's awesome. It's so monstrous. I don't get tired of it. I'm addicted to it. I love it. My God. My favorite lyrics on the album are actually one that surprised me. I wasn't quite expecting to choose these lyrics, but you know, life chooses them for you sometimes. My favorite lyrics are actually from Cheap Day Return. Really the whole song, I suppose. On Preston platform, do your soft shoe shuffle dance. Brush away the cigarette ash that's falling down your pants. And then you sadly wonder, does the nurse treat your old man the way she should? She made you tea, asked for your autograph. What a laugh. As I was going through the album and listening and reading to the lyrics, these words stuck out to me. I would imagine, especially in my personal life now, after I've had a recent death in the family. And part of that was when they were in hospice care and, you know, I was thinking about them. I remember one of the nights specifically after I left, driving home, and I was wondering, you know, I hope that they're treating her well. I hope that the nurses and people that are taking care of her, I hope that they're taking care of her the way that I would, or at least that I would want to be taken care of. So after reading those lyrics, they hit me. I knew it. These were the ones that stuck out to me, and these are my favorite ones on the album. And then getting into my song rankings for the album, My God, Mother Goose, Cheap Day Return, Wondering Aloud, Hymn 43, Locomotive Breath, Up to Me, Aqualung, Cross-Eyed Mary, Slipstream, Wind Up. Now, honestly, as I mentioned before, I don't really think that there's a weak track on this album. I think that some are not as stellar or standout-ish as others, but as an album, I don't really think you could ask for really much better. Every single musician in the band really gets in on this album. I don't feel like any of them are underplayed. I feel like many of them are probably at the forefront of the music. Members like Barr and Ian Anderson. But let's not forget the amazing percussion of Clive Bunker, the bass playing of John Hammond, and the beautiful piano and organ from Mr. John Evans. Every single member really packs a punch into this knockout of an album. And I definitely enjoyed it. And it's going to be one of those albums that I listen to probably for a long time. Of course, I would love to know what you guys think of Aqualung. I would love to know, what are your favorite moments on the album? What's your favorite lyrics? What are your favorite songs on the album? I hope that you enjoyed this review, and like I said, you can go back and watch all of my first reactions to each song on the album, if you have the time. You can also join me on Twitter, where sometimes I post stuff. Join me in the comments down below just to discuss and talk with not only me, but fellow music and Jethro Tull lovers. You can also support the channel over on Patreon, but you don't have to. As long as you've enjoyed the video and enjoyed my company, I've enjoyed your company, and I hope that you're having a fantastic and a beautiful day. And I'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye.